anything, but our next talk is October 1st, maybe. And it's going to be awesome, but the title is escaping me. And it's on the schedule, and we'll get flyers out, but it is something in ancient philosophy.
Friendship and Virtue in Plato's Republic.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much. Look at that. The president, are you president of our?
I'm the Duchess Dragon.
Yeah. She is the vice president. I am the president.
President of Philosophy Club. Mm-hmm. Thanks for coming out. Today it is my real pleasure to bring Dr. Camisha Russell from Colorado College, where she's the Riley Scholar in Residence. And I just wanted to note, especially for students who are in the seminar with me this semester, one of her many publications, Black American Sexuality and the Repressive Hypothesis, Reading Patricia Hill Collins with Michelle Foucault, which is in Convergences, Black Women and Continental Philosophy. So we're reading Patricia Hill Collins for today, Michelle Foucault figures in the seminar. Go check it out, it's awesome. Her paper today is The Race Idea in Reproductive Technologies. Please help me welcome Dr. Camisha Russell.
Thank you. So in the grand philosophical tradition, I will be just reading, but hopefully in an animated way that you will be able to follow well. And I will hopefully project as well to the back of the room here. Okay, so we live in an era when many people place a great deal of hope in the powers of science and technology to solve problems and give us better lives. In this paper, I look at the ability of science and technology to tackle the question of race and to fight racism. Describing the difference between so-called scientific race theory and what can be called the race idea, I argue that a typical scientific approach to race errs in placing too much emphasis on what race is or is not, rather than on what race does, that is, the function of ideas of race in various social and political landscapes. Shifting our focus from arguments about the reality of race to analyses of the social operations of the race idea is crucial to the complex and nuanced study of race and bioethical issues. To demonstrate this importance, I examine the role that the race idea plays in assisted reproductive technologies, or ARTs. I also call into question the way in which a desire to pursue justice through technology can draw attention away from the true roots of social inequality. So first section, race theory versus the race idea. One of the many noble uses to which science was put in the second half of the 20th century is in fighting racism. Taking race science to be one of the key factors in the creation and maintenance of racism, well-meaning scientists and other academics have used research in the natural sciences to disprove either the very existence of biological race or any connections between biological race and physical health, moral character, and/or mental capacity. Though such approaches might be framed as purely objective scientific work, they do not stand apart from important ethical aims. Within philosophy of race, the position that race is not a scientifically valid concept and should therefore be abandoned is called eliminativist constructivism. In his well-known arguments for this position, which has been modified since, Anthony Appiah pointed to a passage from science writer Paul Hoffman's 1994 article, The Science of Race, which concluded that, quote, race accounts for only a minuscule 0.012% difference in our genetic material. For Appiah, this was evidence of the non-existence of race. Race, he argued, is an essentially biological concept that is supposed to allow for meaningful classification of human beings into scientifically delineable groups such that their shared physiological features, e.g. skin color, would be predictive of other group traits. Thus, if we cannot come up with such scientifically delineable groups, or if the groups we can come up with do not allow us to draw any correlations with moral or social traits, then the race concept fails. In other words, if there are no races, the race concept must be rejected. Eliminativist constructivists, along with many of those who argue against abandoning the concept of race, typically take themselves to be involved in work on and debates over the metaphysics of race. As Anna Stubblefield has pointed out, however, different philosophers' arguments concerning the reality of race may actually be based in those philosophers' moral convictions about whether or not we should take race into account in our individual moral reasoning. She believes that, at its heart, the debate is a consequentialist one over whether taking race into account only perpetuates anti-Black oppression or is in fact necessary to effectively combat such oppression. This is a crucial question. While it may seem important to marshal evidence against the scientific legacy, legitimacy of racism, And while that evidence may be compelling, we should also consider how well such an approach actually serves or obstructs efforts to end racial oppression. Such an approach places the problem of racism in individual minds and seeks to change those minds by appealing to reason. Focusing on racism as a dangerous set of false beliefs, however, obscures another understanding of racism, as a politically powerful set of sedimented social practices. As Robert Bernasconi describes, attempts aimed at challenging beliefs in the correlation between genetic heritage and moral, cultural, or intellectual capacities are problematic because they leave intact a world, quote, structured by past racisms that cannot be located at the level of thought, because they are now, and probably were always, primarily located within practices that are sustained not so much by individuals, but by institutions, both local and global. It is also worth pointing out that very few people seriously espouse beliefs in biological racial inferiority these days. Yet racial discrimination and deep structural inequalities between racial groups persist. This suggests that scientific racism is, and may have always been, a straw man, unworthy of the bulk of our anti-racist focus. Indeed, scientific challenges to the race concept are nothing new. Erich Vogelin, a German-born political theorist working in Austria during the rise of National Socialism in Germany, years before Appiah's birth, addresses this tendency by arguing for a distinction between race theory, an endeavor of the natural sciences, and the race idea, a fundamentally political concept. Quote, when we speak of the race idea, he writes, we have in mind chiefly the idea as it is used by modern creeds of the type of National Socialism in order to integrate a community spiritually and politically. His concern is with race as a tool for defining and shaping communities, which is not the sort of thing that can be proven true or false. While Vogelin acknowledges that theories of race have proved empirically unverifiable and believes this to be a valid criticism, he argues that a, quote, symbolic idea like the race idea is not a theory in the strict sense of the word. Precisely because the race idea is not a theory, such criticism, while correct, is without meaning because it is not the function of an idea to describe social reality, but to assist in its constitution. The point of a race idea is not simply to recognize differences between groups, but to establish and maintain those differences. Thus, we must recognize that, though the use of the race idea purports to be based in and supported by scientific race theory, to criticize the race idea by pointing to the flaws in the supposedly supporting scientific theory is only half the battle, the very well-worn half. Vogelin recommends a different sort of scientific analysis, one that goes beyond questioning the biological or even the cultural existence or reality of racial groups or racial difference on the basis of empirical data. He calls instead for a methodical description and analysis of the development and function of the race idea as a political symbol and as constitutive of social realities within specific historical contexts. All right, so the race idea in assisted reproduction. Since today's scientists denounce the concept of race in terms of genetics, we might imagine that racial categorizations would be least present in scientific contexts, particularly those focused on genetics. Yet a variety of scholars working in genetics or engaged in the critical study of science or medicine have pointed to the persistence of race as an organizing discourse in these very contexts. Given this persistence, bioethics has an important role to play in shifting the analysis of race issues away from questions about the scientific reality of race in favor of a more complex and productive examination of the function of the race idea. To demonstrate this role, in what follows, I will show how this can and has been accomplished in the context of assisted reproductive technologies. The world of ARTs, particularly where it concerns donor gametes, is notable for its consistent, central, and unapologetic use of racial categorization. This might seem surprising if we see ARTs as part of reproductive medicine, that is, as medical technologies used to treat infertility. When we hear the language of biological, genetic, or biogenetic relation being used to describe those people who provide the gametes, egg or sperm, used in the creation of a child, who may then be raised by other parents, as in the biological mother or the genetic father, we might assume that genetic science serves as an important framework for ART practices. On the other hand, we might understand ARTs as technologies that mimic or correct nature in order to create families. When ARTs are seen as an intimate site in which babies and kinship, parents and children, are created, the importance of race may not seem so surprising after all. Much of the important work establishing the field of bioethics has occurred within a general framework of liberal individualism. As, for example, in Beecham and Childress's famous four principles of bioethics, autonomy, beneficence, non-maleficence, and justice, conceived in terms of fair distribution of goods and services. Such principles and a sincere effort to balance them are very useful in many biomedical contexts. However, ART practitioners, ART consumers, or even lay people faced with media coverage of race issues in ARTs will be unlikely to get from any of these principles to a true understanding of what is at stake in questions of race and reproduction on the personal, social, and political levels. By contrast, if one puts aside one's assumptions about what race is and how it should be considered morally, focusing instead on asking about the function of the race idea in a given ART situation, those stakes are illuminated. To illustrate this, I will examine three common concerns about race in ART contexts. One, whether it is a problem that white people are the primary users of ARTs. Two, whether transracial surrogacy is acceptable or exploitative. And three, whether it is appropriate to classify donor gametes according to race. Okay, so the first subsection of this section, the whiteness of ARTs. For a long time, the image that represented the magic and promise of ARTs was that of a healthy white infant. That image is slowly changing, or at least multiplying, as ARTs are increasingly marketed to families of other races and ethnicities who have the means to pay for fertility treatment. Given this change, and assuming this trend will or ought to be encouraged to continue, we might be tempted to see facts about the race of ART users as a question of distributive justice. Taking race in this matter as a socio-historical categorization, rather than a biological one, we could argue that it is important that all people, no matter what racial background they identify or are identified with, have access to reproductive technologies. We might even go a step further to argue that ARTs should be available to infertile people regardless of socioeconomic status. Such a stance could change a lot of lives and would mark a definite change in the history and present of ART practices. Indeed, were we to assume that, as a solution to the problem of infertility, we would find the highest use of ARTs where infertility rates were highest, we would be sorely misled. Both within the United States and globally, poor women have greater rates of infertility than do middle-class women, but they receive less infertility treatment and are exposed to more childbearing-related risks than more privileged women. Yet this is not simply because ARTs are rarely publicly funded and thus require significant private resources. This disparity can be better understood by looking beyond individual economic means to consider the broader causes of infertility. One major cause of infertility among poor women, and disproportionately minorities, is untreated STDs or poor medical treatment during an earlier birth. Were we interested in helping these women, relatively affordable preventative measures, which would be very good for health in general as well as fertility, seem to make much more sense than expensive ex post facto interventions. Meanwhile, infertility among industrial and agricultural hourly wage workers is often the result of workplace and environmental toxins. ARTs also seem an ill-fitting solution for this population. Indeed, the only systemic infertility problem for which ARTs may seem like the best solution is that of delayed childbearing, which disproportionately affects professional and white-collar workers. And even this is a gendered issue which should itself be deconstructed and would admit a variety of non-medical social solutions. With this recognition, we begin to see that the problem of the whiteness of ARTs may be more than a question of the racial classification of ART users. We must consider how these technologies have arisen and developed with the concerns of a certain population in mind, and what traces they bear of that particular standpoint. When we ask about how the race idea has functioned and continues to function to make our ARTs more accessible or appealing to some groups than others, different sorts of disparity and ideology come to the fore. Though we tend to think of reproductive technologies as those technologies that facilitate reproduction, there are two sides to the technological reproduction coin. On the one side, in the industrialized countries of the West and the North, it is infertility that is of concern to the reproductive experts, who tell us that infertility rates are skyrocketing. On the other side, in the East and the developing South, it is a perception of unrestrained female fertility that justifies invasive medical intervention, like contraceptives and sterilization. Another way to describe these two opposing parts of the world would be as white and non-white. The imagined hyperfertility of non-white people has appeared as a problem in a variety of historical contexts. Anglo-European colonists, particularly in large permanent settlements like that of South Africa, were given to the fear of being swamped by the already majority and seemingly more fertile native populations. In the United States in the early 20th century, immigrants considered non-white seemed to pose a similar threat, providing one of the arguments against making voluntary birth control available to white middle and upper classes. Poor rural whites were also thought to reproduce not only in excess quantity, but of inferior quality, threatening the deterioration of the white race. Since the post-colonial period, the danger posed by excessive fertility in the so-called Third World or Global South has been expressed in terms of global overpopulation. While in the United States, in the second half of the 20th century, it is poor urban blacks who are most often criticized for perpetuating their own poverty and draining state resources by bearing too many illegitimate children. In other words, understandings of when, where, and why fertility or infertility are considered problems are connected to the same long-time assumptions and anxieties that historically fueled various eugenics movements. Assumptions and anxieties about how those populations seen as most fit might be overrun by those seen as least fit. Lisa Ikemoto and others argue that lines drawn in the social imaginary between white and non-white, the infertile and the too fertile, not only unconsciously guide ART thinking and policy in the United States, but are also reinforced by it. The image of the infertile white career woman as selfish in exercising too much will by not accepting her natural role as mother stands in contrast to the image of the too fertile woman of color who bears children too young, too often, and out of wedlock due to her inherent weakness of will, her selfish inability to control her sexual appetites, which, through welfare payments, will soon prove a drain on society. The mutually constitutive nature of these images is demonstrated in the following comment from the Chicago Tribune, defending a 59-year-old British woman who, in 1993, was able to give birth to twins by means of egg donation and in vitro fertilization. So this is a slightly long quote from Chicago Tribune. What has the woman done that merits such ethical concern and public criticism? She isn't an unmarried 15-year-old high school dropout whose unplanned baby will put her on welfare, perhaps for decades. She isn't 21 and having her fourth baby by four men, none of whom will actively father their children. She hasn't been using crack or other illegal drugs during pregnancy, condemning her unborn infant to neurological problems of unpredictable severity. She's not passing along the AIDS virus or forcing fetal alcohol syndrome on her child by drinking. She's not risking her baby's health by skipping prenatal care. Her twins aren't the unintended and unwanted consequences of careless sex. So that's the end of that quote. These highly racialized images, which refer very clearly, if not explicitly, to poor black women and girls in the American racial imaginary, are thus used to mark out which women are deserving of motherhood, and therefore of technological assistance in achieving motherhood, and which women are not deserving of motherhood, and should not only not be helped, but should in fact be prevented from becoming mothers. Thus, one function of the race idea in assisted reproductive technologies is to define the reproductive problems different groups of women are experiencing and to dictate when and how they should be helped. When we think about the whiteness of ARTs, then, we must not simply ask whether some non-white women or couples can access ARTs. We must not simply seek ways to further expand access. Rather, we must examine the racialized discourses that encourage certain modes of parenting and family formation while casting other modes as poisonous to society. Okay, race and surrogacy. In gestational or IVF surrogacy, the surrogate carries a child not genetically related to her after the embryo is implanted in her following its in vitro fertilization. Though using a surrogate of a different race would have been physically or logistically possible with traditional surrogacy, where the surrogate is genetically related to the child she carries, it has only become socially possible and indeed desirable with gestational surrogacy. While there are and have been individuals and couples who have opted for interracial and transnational adoption, as far as the use of ARTs is concerned, the expectation has always been that a child created will match the intended parents racially or ethnically. To create a baby of one's own race, with or without technological assistance, is considered so natural as not even to constitute a choice. We can imagine, then, that it would not even occur to white couples seeking traditional surrogates to look for a woman who was anything other than white. Yet, eerily enough, even before the first successful execution of an IVF surrogacy, John Stahura of the Bionetics Foundation Incorporated, an organization that arranged traditional surrogacies, predicted that once it is possible to have a quote, authentic surrogate, that it is a woman who contributes none of the child's genes, clients would, quote, find the breeder's IQ and skin color immaterial, and the surrogate industry could look for breeders not only in poverty-stricken parts of the United States, but in the third world as well. Visionary, that's to her. Stahura also speculated with what turns out to be disturbing accuracy, that in these cases, perhaps one-tenth the current fee could be paid to women. Today, both of Stahura's possibilities have become realities. Women of color in the United States and abroad have served as surrogates for white Western couples. As Amrita Banerjee points out, most of the philosophical literature on commercial surrogacy has analyzed the issues using the ethical paradigms of reproductive liberalism or the exploitation model. In arguments from or marketing based on reproductive liberalism, transnational surrogacy is often seen as providing economic conditions for the surrogate to exercise greater autonomy. In most cases, the surrogate is, after all, making the equivalent of nearly 5 years of total family income. Of course, the fact that the sum is so great relative to the surrogate's other earning opportunities lends support to the opposing exploitation arguments, which point to the oppressive socio-political conditions, both local and global, in which women take up the role of surrogate. But while, according to Banerjee, the reproductive liberalism argument carries the danger of normalizing or naturalizing power imbalances and the exploitation of the less powerful by the more powerful players of globalization, the language or of use and control at the heart of the exploitation paradigm can end up projecting individuals purely as passive victims who are always at the mercy of superior forces external to them. Markins finds the same two competing frames, exploitation slash inequality versus opportunity slash choice, in her analysis of US media framings and public discourses about transnational surrogacy. Ultimately, Banerjee argues that the idea of a transnational reproductive caste system provides a more useful framework, as it highlights, one, the stratification of women's reproductive labor within the global economy along racial and other lines, two, the physical, psychological, and structural violence of the transnational surrogacy industry, and three, the unfair distribution of benefits, burdens, and opportunities across social hierarchies. This and other work that explores how the intersections of various local and global inequalities play out within transnational surrogacy is absolutely essential. For my purposes, however, I would like to isolate the race idea, though such isolation is always artificial, to ask about its specific function in surrogacy practices, focusing on US cases. Though the product of reproductive technologies is often taken to be a healthy child for an infertile couple, Karis Thompson suggests we look at ARTs in a slightly different way, as biotechnological innovations that make not only children, but parents. It is a constitutive feature of ARTs that they enlist people, instruments, and techniques, and often genetic material, outside of or beyond the intended parents in the process of reproduction. This means that the work which occurs in the fertility clinic aims not only to create a child where such creation was not previously possible, but also to ensure that the correct couple or person comes to be understood as the parents of that child. Thompson has called this work ontological choreography, and it includes a process she describes as strategic naturalizing. She defines ontological choreography as, quote, the dynamic coordination of the technical, scientific, kinship, gender, emotional, legal, political, and financial aspects of ART clinics in order to produce parents, children, and everything that is needed for their recognition as such. Crucial to the establishment of kinship is what Thompson calls strategic naturalizing. She elaborates this process by examining patient narratives around two technically identical procedures that lead to different kinship configurations. Gestational surrogacy, on the one hand, and IVF with ovum donation, on the other. Both involve the creation of an embryo through in vitro fertilization and the subsequent implantation of that embryo into a womb. But whereas in gestational surrogacy, the woman who provides the genetic material is the intended mother, in IVF with ovum donation, the intended mother is the woman who gestates the fetus. Noting the different boundaries drawn in patient narratives between what is biological and what is social in conception, pregnancy, and parenting, Thompson argues that there is no fixed natural basis for establishing kinship. Rather, such relations are constructed and then naturalized. Ideas of race, ethnicity, and culture appear here as resources available to fertility patients in their construction of naturalizing narratives, hoping to disambiguate various contributors to the child's birth and to name particular people as the child's true parents. Thompson puts a fairly positive spin on the phenomenon, focusing on cases of donor egg IVF in which the intended mother, who would be carrying the pregnancy, selected a woman of her same race or ethnicity to provide the donor egg. In one case, a woman chose as her donor a friend who, like her, was Italian-American, describing the shared ethnic classification as being, quote, enough genetic similarity. In another, an African-American declared her intention to use an African-American friend or relative as her donor, likening this help to a history of shared parenting practices in African-American communities. In both these cases, racial similarity between intended mother and donor become a resource for highlighting the connection between intended mother and child. By contrast, in gestational surrogacy, while the genetic connection of the child to the intended parents is thought to establish the child as theirs, the racial difference between the surrogate and the child gestated becomes a resource for establishing that child as not hers. The prevalence of attributing this kind of hereditary certainty and security to visible racial similarity and difference, also a significant element in the case of transnational gestational surrogacy, is attested to by the fact that Helena Rigone finds the same attitude among domestic surrogates, who reported that contracting with couples of a different race from their own helped them to maintain a distance between themselves and the children they were carrying. In the well-publicized 1993 case of Johnson v. Calvert, Anna Johnson, a single black woman, fought Mark and Crispina Calvert, a white man and a Filipina woman, for the rights to a child who was genetically theirs, but whom Johnson had carried and delivered. As Valerie Hartooni describes, racial ideas and images were deployed in the case to discredit Johnson and her connection to the child, while shoring up the Calvert's claim. For example, the fact that Johnson was black and had once been on welfare, which was brought up in court, quote, signified moral depravity, lack of veracity, and a capacity for deception, and marked her as someone capable of deceiving the Calverts and exploiting their procreative yearnings in a coldly calculated fashion for gain, indeed as someone who lied rather than simply changed her mind. Meanwhile, Crispina Calvert asserted repeatedly in court and to the press, he looks just like us. Moreover, race was used to strategically denaturalize Johnson's very desire to keep the child she carried. Dominant reproductive discourse tends to portray gestation, and particularly quickening, as naturally and universally arousing in women a deep biologically rooted sense of maternal desire. What then, Hartooni asks, quote, rendered Johnson's claim so remarkably queer, unfathomable, deviant, or unusual, in fact so specious as to inspire Superior Court Judge Richard Parslow to pathologize it as criminal, as a potential instrument for future emotional and financial extortion, and to dismiss it as groundless. The answer seems to lie not merely in Anna Johnson's race, but in the perceived racial difference between her and the child she carried. Thus, the claim by the Calvert's lawyers that Johnson had been motivated to sue for custody not, as she claimed, because of maternal instincts that had just come out naturally, but rather because she fetishized whiteness. These examples suggest that, for good or ill, conceptions of racial similarity and difference play an important and active role in helping to resolve tensions about who should be considered the real parents of children produced by ARTs. Moreover, the cases in which racial difference is used to discredit reproductive relations or desires shows that the race idea can be used even where there is not agreement between all parties, and well beyond the confines of the fertility clinic. As a major factor in assisted reproduction, then, race served at one time to limit the pool of women available to serve as surrogate mothers to infertile couples. With the advent and improvement of the technologies that make possible gestational surrogacy, a much wider pool of women has become available, which has resulted in the creation of a surrogacy industry predicated on structural inequality. Within that industry, not only are race and color significant factors in determining the relative market value of biological material and reproductive labor, but the race idea itself also serves key ideological functions. Okay, so, racial classification of donor gametes. According to Dahl Fox, 23 of the 28 sperm banks operating in the United States provide aspiring parents with information about donor skin color, and the largest banks organize sperm donor directories into discrete sections on the basis of race. In fact, until recently, at one major sperm bank, stored and shipped semen in color-coded vials. A white cap and white cane indicated a Caucasian donor, a black cap and black cane indicated an black African-American donor, the yellow cap and yellow cane indicated an Asian donor, and a red cap and red cane indicated donors of unique or mixed ancestry. This measure was designed to ease fears of racial mix-ups, which, when they have occurred, have garnered significant media attention, as in the 1990 case where a white couple sought artificial insemination with what was supposed to be the husband's sperm and ended up with a child described as black. As Patricia Williams recounts, the woman sued not simply because she had been inseminated with the wrong sperm, but when, quote, the racial taunting of her child became unbearable. Race also plays a major role in the description of the emotional and economic damage alleged in a 2014 suit, in which one member of a lesbian couple was inseminated with the sperm of a black donor rather than the white one they had selected. Fears about the discrimination the child will face, worries about racially insensitive family members, difficulty in getting the child good hair care, and the possibility of having to relocate to a more racially diverse neighborhood have all been cited by the couple and their lawyer. It is not hard to defend these lawsuits in liberal terms. The parents in question made choices on offer to them, paid for services, and received something different than what they had chosen. The providers in question not only made mistakes, but did so in the arena of reproduction, an arena within which we have good ethical reason to insist on privacy and respect for personal choice. But respect for personal choice does not seem to apply in all cases involving race and ARTs. Rather, there's a strong expectation that people will choose to have children who match them racially. And violations of this rule, especially the idea of a non-white person choosing to have a white child in order to confer social advantage upon that child, are not well received. The anxieties produced by the crossing of the color line in ARTs became visible in a series of stories from early 1994 reacting to the fact that a black woman had chosen to be implanted with embryos made with ova from a white woman. On Ikimoto's account, quote, the image of a black woman claiming authority over a white child inverts the racially based rules of status and ownership. While the use of transracial egg donation to change the conclusion that blackness begets blackness challenges the assumption that black mothers create the traits deemed inferior by white supremacy. Thus, the woman's decision was held up as an example of science going too far, with the immutability of race marking, quote, the desirable line between the natural and the unnatural. Practitioners have also been known to police their clients' donor selections on the basis of race. Celine Quiroga records the following description of an interaction between fertility patient Rochelle and the first physician she consulted. So this is a long quote from Rochelle. We talked briefly, and he asked me whether or not I had any questions. Well, I just said, well, how do you try to match the physical characteristics of the husband? And he says, well, you know, unless your husband has any real distinguishing features, usually it's not difficult to do that. And I said, well, I think my husband's most distinguishing feature is the fact that he's black. And he goes, oh, I don't have any black donors in the program. And immediately in my mind, I kind of moved past it. I said, well, okay, well, I'll take anything in, you know, the color range. I said, if you have, you know, Hispanic, Puerto Rican, you have somebody, I mean, a tangent. I mean, all, those are all people with African descent over history and time. Hey, I'm not going to be too flipped out or too choosy about it. I'm open. It's only sperm. And the baby's going to be half black or something because it's going to be my baby, right? So I didn't trip off it. And he says to me, oh, no, I do not think that would be appropriate at all. So, end of that quote. More recently, in July 2014, a story broke about a single white Canadian woman, Catherine, who was told by a private Calgary sperm bank that she could only purchase sperm from donors of her same ethnicity, i.e. white donors. Calvin Green, the doctor who directly forbade Catherine from selecting the sperm of the non-white donors in whom she'd expressed interest, cited an explicit clinic policy available on its website at the time the story broke. Quote, it is the practice of the regional fertility program not to permit the use of a sperm donor that would result in a future child appearing racially different than the recipient or the recipient's partner. This copy was removed from the website the following week, and the clinic released a statement saying that the policy, in place since the 1980s, had been discontinued a year earlier. Green is quoted as explaining, quote, I'm not sure that we should be creating rainbow families just because some single woman decides that's what she wants. That's her prerogative, but it's not her prerogative in our clinic. While the ostensible defense of placing racial labels on donor gametes is one of consumer reproductive rights or liberty, often accompanied by a downplaying of the continued importance or relevance of race in today's society, such that it is just one consumer choice among many, the expectation and policing of racial matching suggests that it is actually the individual's or couple's own possession of the racial identity that confers the right to bestow that same identity upon the child to be created. As Ikimoto puts it, quote, despite common knowledge of basic genetics and despite our apparent embrace of colorblindness as a legal standard and social norm, we still see race as immutable. The race idea here, renaturalized, can be seen as performing at least two functions. First, as Ikimoto has pointed out, the supposed immutability of race can be used as a boundary, marking how far science and technology should and should not go. Reproductive technologies are attempts to correct or improve upon nature, ways of pushing past natural limits to fulfill human projects and desires. However, because reproductive technologies are interventions in that which is seen as most natural in human life, they inevitably provoke anxieties about shifting boundaries of the natural and unnatural, which by definition are supposed to be fixed. The visceral nature of our feelings about race and the shadow cast by the eugenics of the early 20th century may combine to convince us that allowing people to make choices about race is the line that must not be crossed. Race must be left to nature and not allowed under human control. The extreme irony of this thinking, of course, is the fact that race, when understood as the race idea, not the variation of human phenotypes, has never been natural and has always been under human control. It is people and societies who have picked out certain physical features, classified them as racial, assigned them further meaning, and used them for social and political ends. Which leads to the second function of the race idea in this ART context. By asserting the transmission of racial identity through reproduction as natural rather than political, the race idea in ART discourses normalizes existing racialized privilege and inequality. As Robert reminds us, in US society, quote, perhaps the most significant genetic trait passed from parent to child is race. Imagine what would be up for grabs if racial status were no longer fixed in this way. Okay. I think this is the last section. Medicalized, personalized, depoliticized. By turning our attention away from the truth or falsity of race science and focusing instead on the functions of the race idea, we have taken our bioethical analysis of race and assisted reproductive technologies to a deeper level. We see that correcting harmful beliefs, as in beliefs about racial superiority / inferiority, through scientific knowledge may not be enough to bring about positive social change. But we have not looked at the supposed power of technology to bring about such change. As Martin Heidegger and other philosophers of technology have pointed out, the human drive to gather and improve scientific knowledge is intimately connected to the drive to master and control nature. This drive for mastery and a focus on technological solutions over other possible approaches to things like human suffering and social inequality can also have racial overtones and racist consequences. The aforementioned methods of assisted reproduction are practiced within a larger social and medical context that includes what Lee M. Silver has dubbed reprogenetics. Quote, the use of genetic information and technology to ensure or prevent the inheritance of particular genes in a child. Indeed, we seem to have entered what we might call an era of liberal or neoliberal eugenics. Such an era is characterized not only by the increasing availability of reprogenetics, often offered as individualized market choices, but also by the sense that procreation carries with it a personal responsibility, such that one must try to avoid bearing any children with genetic flaws who might prove a burden on society. As Nicholas Rose describes, in, quote, advanced liberal democracies, strategies of rule must not seek to govern through society, but through the regulated choices and aspirations to self-actualization and self-fulfillment. Insofar as national or social prosperity is thought to be achieved through individual prosperity, and insofar as individual prosperity is thought to require personal freedom, the state is believed to be taking a back seat, while individuals are not simply left, but rather exhorted to govern themselves. It is important for proponents of so-called liberal eugenics that their practices of making better children be distinguished from reviled former practices of eugenics in virtue of a lack of state-sponsored coercion and a lack of racially motivated agenda. Reproductive and reprogenetic technologies must be chosen and used without state intervention so as to escape obvious forms of power and domination. Yet these private interactions involve the exercise of great deals of power. In his discussion about the ethics of all forms of human enhancement, including so-called designer children, Michael Sandel argues that the language of autonomy, fairness, and individual rights that permeates discussion of the issue fails to capture much of our deep uneasiness about the pursuit of perfection. Some opponents fear that genetic enhancements will undermine our humanity by threatening our capacity to act freely, to succeed by our own efforts, and to consider ourselves responsible, worthy of praise or blame, for the things we do and for the way we are, as in athletes who succeed via biotechnological enhancement of their skill. By contrast, Sandel argues that the deeper danger enhancements represent is a kind of hyper-agency. Far from simply allowing people to do as they like or to freely pursue their individual projects, the available of enhancements and biotechnological fixes appears as a bid for compliance, a way of answering a competitive society's demand to improve our performance and perfect our nature. where we believe we fully control our or our human or our children's traits and abilities, we lack an appreciation for the role of luck in our lives, for chance as a factor in our successes and the failures of others. Rather than acknowledging what Sartre called our facticity, even as we recognize that we have freedom in how we take up those givens of life, the availability of genetic enhancement suggests there are no givens with which one must contend. This leads to an overheightened sense of responsibility, according to which, though we may also be praised for our skills and successes, we must be blamed for any lacks or failures. Socio-historical factors shaping one's life possibilities and outcomes, like racial prejudice and discrimination, fade into the background. In the face of this dogmatic belief in individual responsibility, social solidarity is diminished. After all, if everyone is personally responsible for his or her own lot, there's little reason to respond with sympathy to those who are suffering or in need. In a similar vein, Roberts argues that there are crucial similarities between the reprogenetic technologies aimed at the middle and upper class women whose reproduction is generally encouraged, and those contraceptive technologies aimed at poor and non-white women, which she understands as privatization and punishment, respectively. Both population control programs and genetic selection technologies, she suggests, reinforce biological explanations for social problems and place reproductive duties on women that shift responsibility for improving social conditions away from the state. The new or heightened responsibilities that emerge as reprogenetics become more accessible and more powerful are simply the latest iteration of a highly racialized discourse. The many real problems plaguing poor and minority communities have long been blamed on irresponsible reproductive decisions within those communities, rather than on an extensive and continuing history of racist marginalization, exploitation, and discriminatory social policy. Though proponents of these technologies are likely sincere in their desire to use scientific knowledge and power to improve all lives, the contemporary focus on genetic correction and enhancement risks exacerbating rather than reversing this racist trend. A focus on individually accessed technological solutions implies that social and political solutions aimed at structural inequalities are misguided, ineffectual, or unnecessary. A privatization of the sources of inequality thus depoliticizes them. So, in conclusion, science and technology appear to be important and authoritative sources for justice and social improvement. Both disproving any scientific basis for racism and empowering individuals through technology seem like laudable goals. Unfortunately, pursuing these goals risks gravely oversimplifying the root causes and ongoing mechanisms of racism and racial injustice, drawing our attention away from the continuing operation of the race idea in bioethical contexts, and monopolizing the resources needed to fundamentally restructure our racist, social, and political landscape. Ultimately, I suspect that ART policy and practice will not prove to be ideal sites for such restructuring, since they only represent a much larger and longstanding racial politics of reproduction. Since the racial decision-making in ARTs can be relatively stark, however, their importance as a diagnostic tool for measuring the power of race the race idea will likely remain. Thank you.
We have time for some questions. Yeah, David.
Thank you for your talk. It was really interesting. I heard a podcast recently about abortion, and the author, I forget her name, but she was maintaining that if you look at the science of pregnancy, the substance ontology is questioned, because what you have between the fetus and the mother is a dynamic system. And it would seem that that kind of way of looking at an interactive single whole would be a way to advance some of the attacks on the liberal paradigm, which you're challenging. Do any of the people who talk about these issues challenge the metaphysical basis of pregnancy?
Yeah, I would not a lot. No, I mean, I think that's that issue sort of implicit when you're talking about how the race idea is then sort of coming in and being used to naturalize or denaturalize certain relationships. So, I mean, that sort of example that Thompson gives between the gestational surrogacy and the IVF with egg donation, right, is that, you know, so it's two identical processes, right, and then people are trying to say in one case this person is the mother, and in that case the other one. So I think there's implicit in that analysis the idea that... that this kind of division is artificial, but I haven't seen a lot of people really sort of taking that up as a way to challenge it. But again, and again, that's what
it seems the yeah. you know the false science of race is used to create property.
Right.
But in
yeah.
but a scientific approach could also be used to sort of attack the property notion
yeah.
too, and look at the contribution of the gestational participant.
Yeah, I definitely think so. I mean, similarly, you know, with genetics, sort of epigenetics and things looking at environmental interaction with genes, I think also can serve those, you know, so that's a place where as the science itself becomes more nuanced and deepens its understanding of how things go, that's the interesting thing. I think this goes to Vogelin's point about race science and the race idea, is that it's not even necessarily that the science, it really has little to do with how good or bad or advanced or unadvanced the science is, but actually people are just sort of taking things up and you know, they'll change as the scientific terminology changes, they'll change the way they describe, but it will be sort of socially conservative in a way, right? So
mm-hmm.
they'll just take the new science and kind of try to shape it towards, you know, justifying social and political status quo. So I think science is there sort of offering these different paradigms for thinking these things through, but that doesn't always mean that will lead people to sort of, you know, to the deeper social and political questions. Sometimes it will just sort of lead them to take the new science and try to apply it in favor of the same kind of, the same old, same old.
So in the distinction between, okay, I'm drawn to your distinction of the Western Northern concept of infertility being the focus, and if I'm correct, the Eastern Southern concept of too much fertility being the focus.
Well, it's the Western view of the global South or the third world, right? It's not their self-view.
Sure.
Right, but the way that you know, they're sort of othered as this hyper fertile kind of population. Yeah.
Okay, so where I'm going towards though is, do you ever foresee a solution to that dichotomy, given that many people who are now surrogates are coming from, say, India or those cultures where, as you mentioned, there's an economic disparity? Is there a true autonomy in a decision making on the part of a surrogate who is economically impoverished, and could we argue that there's a true autonomous decision, number one? And two, do you ever foresee this not being a socioeconomic issue? So for instance, is there gonna be a lottery of sorts that would even the playing field? I mean, I'd love to see, instead of the, like, the white cane, black cane, and whatever canes, it's just like, it's a lottery. And I mean, I'm being kind of somewhat facetious as a joke, but I'm serious about the deeper question. I mean, who's seeking the fertility treatment? It's going to be people of a socioeconomic status to begin with, and I'm going to assert that it's going to continue to be that way. Is there ever going to be a level playing field concerning the socioeconomic disparity of who is seeking fertility treatments? There's maybe three questions there.
Yeah.
I'll hush.
Yeah. No, I mean, I don't. You know, I dream of a world at night that is like, you know, that is free of social inequality. But I mean, you know, I guess the sort of, you know, point that I wanted to make, and that I think you know, Banerjee wants to point to and stuff, is that either way, when you can't really get a good answer to this question of autonomy, because certainly if you can you know, make 5 total years of you know, family income by being a surrogate, you often they're typically, I guess, and this is an aspect that I didn't talk about here, but surrogates, you know, go away to a place like a dorm. There's, so the clinic runs a dorm. This, of course, makes the contracting couples happy, because then the surrogate's being monitored, right? They know what she's eating and what medicine she's getting, and she can't run off and do whatever she wants, and, you know, I mean, so which is also creepy. And this is the thing, like, that's creepy on the one hand, but also for the women in question, it's sometimes very convenient, because they can make up an excuse about why they're going to be gone for 9 months or however, you know, and they can be off visiting somebody in some other part of India, like a family member, and taking care of them, and they can go deliver this child, make this money, and come back to their community without having to admit to anybody that this is something that they did, right? So, so there's all, I think, you know, it's always each way, you know, kind of goes each way, right? Like, on the one hand, there's this sort of creepy panoptic surveillance kind of going on of these women, and it's that's the appeal of that to contracting couples is creepy as well. But on the other hand, it helps the woman who's making this, you know, the surrogate who's, you know, in whatever constrained circumstances, making this choice to get this money, it helps her to do that without inviting social shame or anything like that. Right, and her other opportunities are not great, right? So it's not like, well, I could make a good living in this job that I can get in my community, or I could, you know, make a little bit of extra money by being a surrogate, but oh, maybe I'm really uncomfortable with that, I'll just take a job, right? It's really a case of very few earning opportunities locally, especially for women, and then this one really big one, right? So I think that, you know, I mean, so I think that's what makes the question of autonomy so tricky. And I think that's why Banerjee and I, you know, want to go away from asking about this autonomy or exploitation thing and say, well, look, what we have to really look at is these larger global circumstances. And unless magically someday they really evened out, we wouldn't have any sense of, you know, which women want to be surrogates, you know, for whatever reason, and which women don't, right? They're always making this choice, unless it's a, you know, like a family member or something like that, right? Whereas what they call altruistic surrogacy. But in all of these commercial situations, you have to have this pool of people, whether it's women of color in the U.S. or poor women in the U.S. or, or abroad, you have to have women who need money and don't see themselves as being able to make it in other kinds of ways, right? And so it's really hard to imagine any kind of reproductive market in a sense without those various inequalities. And you even have, there's a lot of, this is a very simplified kind of two-sided look at the reproductive, transnational economy or whatever, but there are also women with white or light skin from poor countries like, you know, the Ukraine or something, who donate eggs into this, or not donate, but sell eggs into this market, right? So, which is something that most Indian women wouldn't be able to do because the eggs of Indian women is not as valued as their reproductive labor. So you have some women suited to reproductive material, and some women, suited to reproductive labor, and then even within India, and especially with, Indian couples living abroad and stuff like that, they also will use surrogates back in India, but their questions of caste as well as skin color and all that kind of stuff will come into how much a woman can earn for even doing the gestating work, which is interesting. So even lighter-skinned Indian women would get more for gestating a baby than a darker-skinned one. Even, you know, assuming, you know, even with the idea that that's actually a genetic property and not something that would would matter for the gestational case. So, but yeah, I don't think you have, I don't know what a surrogacy or a reproductive exchange or helping out would look like without that inequality to kind of fuel people, and it affects people in the U.S. It's not necessarily that you have lots of money, you probably don't go to India for a surrogate, because the reason that you go to India for a surrogate is because it's much cheaper. So even comparing sort of middle class to much more one percenters kind of in the U.S. right, you get differences in what they can do, like. So probably one percenters would just as soon have somebody close by as a surrogate. But for middle class couples, it's, you know, it's incredibly expensive to do in the U.S., to have a surrogate in the U.S., and it's much cheaper in India. And you get tutors packages, too. They sell them together with tutors packages. So you can go and do the IVF and all that stuff.
So you go like the Himalayas and pick up your baby?
Yeah. And you have to go at least twice, right? You have to go once for the, because also the medical services are cheaper, right? So just straight up, even if you didn't want a surrogate, just straight up going to India for IVF would be cheaper than getting IVF. Yeah, and that's the same sort of medical tourism. You know, India is popular because there are a lot of exceptionally well-trained, Western-trained doctors in India. They speak English, exactly. And the government has been pretty lax on laws about that and favorable towards the industry rather than terribly concerned about the rights of women. So there's a lot of, you know, so you save a lot of money in a variety of ways. But so even for, you know, the society of the people who are supposedly much more privileged, it is actually also a relative inability to pay for the medical costs of trying to conceive in the U.S. that even drives people towards that market. So it's even a sort of relative lack of privilege in the U.S. context that forces people towards the international market anyway.
Yeah, we got one.
So why is there, I guess because like we're talking about the distinction between some of the, or how babies of color are undervalued because of their genes, and even like people would rather have someone of lighter complexion carry their children. What is the demand, do you think, for reproducing a pure white baby? Like, does that make sense?
Yeah, I think this really comes out in the cases of the, you know, the racial mix-ups, right, where the white couples end up with non-white babies that they weren't planning on, right? So it's okay if you're like sort of following the noble example of Brad Pitt and Angelina Jolie and you do it on purpose, but if you sort of wanted a white baby and you don't get one, then it's like really upsetting. But I think what happens in those moments is that people who have previously not given a lot of thought to the privilege that they enjoy come to see that something a privilege they expected to be passed on to their children is suddenly not going to be available. And I think that's very terrifying and upsetting for people. So, you know, I personally find the lesbian couple very frustrating. But they also even sort of say, well, we understand discrimination, you know, but, you know, this isn't what we ordered. they even try to say we get that there's discrimination, right? But then they start to talk about these sort of inconveniences, and you think, well, you know, now you have to deal with the racist members of your family, but like people who are not white deal with racist members of society all the time, and they have to, right? Now you have to, live in a neighborhood that's not completely white. Well, again, this is something that arguably you should only raise children in neighborhoods that are not completely white, because that's, you know, like that's a too, you know, sheltered and artificial in existence, right? You know, so arguably any good parent would take their child to a diverse neighborhood to raise them so that they could become better people, right? So I mean, there's these sort of I find them frustrating, but at the same time, I'm not completely unsympathetic to what they're experiencing. But I think, you know, it's this moment, I think, when people realize the privilege that they've had, and you know, of course, we all want, you know, to have our children live good lives, right? And then this is a particularly, you know, we're even, you know, arguably more concerned about the lives our children are going to leave even than the ones we do, right? So, I mean, so you can see why this really upsets them, right? They're worried about all these negative things that their child might face now. But again, at the same time, it's this sort of confrontation with a privilege they expected and they're not going to get. So I think that perhaps even more openly earlier, before sort of the colorblindness norm really took a lot of root, I think people really knew that, well, of course, you would want a white baby. Why would you want anything else? That's what's best in society. And I think now, that's something people aren't going to say as freely. But like I said, in these cases where they were expecting that and that's not what they get, it suddenly comes clear to them that there's all these difficulties their child is going to have to face and they're going to face that they wouldn't have to before. But of course, this lacks the recognition that all these unjust difficulties are applied to lots of people who don't, you know, who aren't white, and who didn't have that that privilege and expectation in the first place. So I think it's, and that's why I think that assisted reproductive technologies are really an interesting site to look at, because there's a lot more deliberate decision making that actually mimics a long-term and really strong social rules that have again been kind of fallen out of favor, but still are, you know, still are cared about in terms of marrying within one's own race and who is an appropriate reproductive partner and all that. So I think some parents very much still care about that, but it's not able to be talked about as even as openly as, you know, like when my parents got married, my grandmother made it clear to my mother that she did not want her to marry a black man, and that she didn't go to the wedding, and my grandfather didn't go to the wedding either, and all this, you know, so that was like sort of just able to just kind of be done and understood. And I think that's maybe getting trickier in our social climate, but still the same sort of fears about, well, but what's going to happen to children, and what kinds of things are they going to face, and what are you doing to your life by doing this, I think still do exist. And I think we see that in these racial mix-ups, and even in the decisions that result in not, you know, don't result in a mix-up, but, you know, just the sort of, you know, automatically choosing racial matching, I think, really.
Oh, the hair care problem.
Yes. You know, it's the funny thing is, it's not nothing. I grew up in a really white town, and I really was. It was quite difficult to get hair care. So I'm not. You know,
we're
going to
get white babies,
yeah,
right? She said,
yeah,
"Are we going to get white babies, or are we going to get brown babies?" And she's like, "My wife is French, and she's white." She's like, "I could not leave my baby in her. What if I die?"
Right.
So, yeah.
Poor
kid would be.
So I mean, so it's interesting, right? Because these are sort of actual. I mean, they absolutely should definitely take the child to get their hair done in a good place. this is important, right? Like, yeah. But yeah, it's sort of, but it's interesting, yeah.
I was interested in the disparities that you were talking about with respect to the sources of infertility to begin with.
Yeah.
And wanted to know if you could say something more about that. The reason I'm asking is because I know that. Was it Google or one of the other tech companies that was offering to freeze eggs for women because, right, so that they would stay on the career path and not, like, sap their competitive edge by having babies, and we know that ruins careers. but that's a really different kind of reason than one that sort of built into the culture itself, right? Than things like untreated STDs and toxins in the workplace. I just wondered if you had something else to say about that, or if there is any way of thinking about that that's not, I guess, maybe it's not all racially based. It seems like income based as well.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, and race and socioeconomic status are, you know, really hard to disentangle, and it's sort of not fruitful to do so. You sort of have to take it together, I think.
But it is interesting that there is this very highly educated white collar kind of job that really is intending to. I mean, they're suggesting we'll offer you this wonderful benefit, but the idea is, because we effectually going to make you infertile if you want to keep your job.
We
don't want you pregnant.
And that's the thing. And there are just so many other ways to look at getting around that, right? There are, you know, sort of, you know, childcare, for example.
Oh.
You know,
maternity leave.
So it's interesting though, right? Because these are solutions that sort of you know, portray themselves as benefits, and they do also do so unthinkingly. I mean, it's actually not, you know, the results with frozen eggs are not as good. You know, I mean, so,
right.
You know, I mean, sort of saying that, oh, and then, you know, sort of saying, well, technology is the answer to this, right? You know, so you're just going to work as we expect our male workers to do, and then I don't know at what point you stop then wanting your career to go well and decide to do use the frozen eggs, but like, but, you know, but this idea that, well, technology is going to save us and allow us to continue, and I think this is, you know, you could sort of see this in environmental approaches as well, right? It's going to allow us to continue on this path that we're very accustomed to, that we like, we don't want to change, right? So technology can fix our environmental problems rather than us, you know, changing the way that we use the environment, right, or abuse the environment, right? So there's this idea of, like, we want to continue to do business the way we've been doing it, but we recognize either A, that, you know, women make good workers, or B, that women like to accuse us of being sexist and we don't give them things, or whatever, I mean, you know, whatever motivates this, right? But then, you know, but we want to continue with the way that we're doing things rather than, or even acknowledging, say, that maybe some of their male workers might want to have families and might want to actually know those children in some kind of, you know, closer, intimate way. So instead of, you know, sort of restructuring a workplace to be family friendly for men and women to have children at younger ages, if they, you know, so choose, right, then the idea is, let's just continue the way that we are with our same values and our same structure, but then we'll offer this sort of technological solution, which again, realistically, does not give you the same odds of having a successful, you know, conception and pregnancy. So. Yeah, so I think it's, and that's I think, you know, what I was trying to kind of get at the last part of the paper too, is that these, this idea of technology as this solution and equalizing thing tends to actually want to continue things the way they are, but then kind of make up for things kind of after the fact with these technological interventions, rather than to ask about what kind of structure have we built up and in what ways is it damaging to our lives and our continued existence. Yeah.
Is there any follow-up that comes out of the people, like the couples who have had unexpected mix-ups with their babies? Do we go like the we'll sue capitalist route, or is there any kind of activism or social growth from the people who experience that?
That's interesting. I don't know. I mean, they certainly the response has been to sue, but whether although I think, oh gosh, I want to say maybe, well, I want to say Scandinavia. I think there was a Scandinavian couple, I don't know which Scandinavian country, who had a racial mix-up, who were just kind of like, okay, other baby, woohoo, you know? So there are examples, but I think that, I mean, that speaks to the extreme importance of race in the U.S., versus the way it's contextualized other places. And, you know, I mean Scandinavia is great and progressive, but also they haven't had to deal with a lot of, you know, the same history. So, I mean, you know, it's much easier for them to be better people. And they've had some real immigration problems.
Yeah, I was going to say.
So you see that when some real challenges kind of come up, they're not always so perfect. Yeah. But yeah, I haven't seen any sort of follow-ups with couples who did these kinds of lawsuits. I mean, I think it can go either way. I think that some white parents who raise non-white children can become very sensitized to issues and very good advocates and much more aware. And some can really still not. And you get this in some of the sort of more dystopic literature from transnational adoptees. So there's sort of one, you know, narrative of sort of grateful, my life made so much better, and another one of, you know, sort of really feeling alienated and stuff like that. So I think it can, you know, as with all people, they can kind of, you know, parents can go either way. They can really sort of come to understand and be more sensitive to the issues, or they can kind of bulldoze past them in a way that's difficult for the children and kind of just maintains, again, the worldview, but brings a non-white individual into that sort of thing, but then doesn't adjust itself for those changes.
But we don't see any literature coming from people who are like, this is what happened and this has
I haven't.
Been the result, or
I mean,
at least
you
maybe
know,
we haven't.
I
haven't,
yeah.
Maybe.
And then, you know, it's yeah, it's, you know, it's only since, it was like, I think 1978, I think, is the first test tube baby or whatever, is the first IVF baby. So it's only, you know, gestational surrogacy has gained great popularity since the 90s, but it's that's still, you know, it hasn't been terribly long. So, but if and there could be, and I just have, but I haven't seen any literature about it, any follow-up. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I was wondering, because I was thinking about this, all the ERTs and the IVF business and everything else, and it's expensive.
Yes.
Right? It's crazy expensive,
yeah.
And that's partially why there's this socioeconomic distinction, is it's insanely expensive. And I kind of wonder if the kind of the racial choices that we see exemplified in some of these decisions here,
mm-hmm.
are really reflective of something that's already taken place. So these are the byproducts or symptoms of a deeper sort of racism that already happened.
Mm-hmm.
Because they've already chosen to do this in the first place,
mm-hmm.
right? They've
yeah.
decided to drop $80,000 on making a baby,
yeah.
when there's plenty of babies out there.
Yeah,
there's babies plenty.
Yes,
right. And that $80,000, you could have picked up a baby on the cheap and put the $80,000 to its father.
Absolutely.
So the very act, perhaps,
yeah.
of that they've already chosen this, that,
yes.
so the choices we're seeing here are kind of the natural byproduct of choosing this process in the first place.
Yes.
I was just thinking about it, so we would expect to see these racial decisions just because they've been chosen to do, say, IVF.
Yeah.
But that's all.
No, that's absolutely true. And in a larger project, I do talk about that a little bit, not a lot, because I've chosen to focus on the ARTs themselves. But yeah, it is, there are some various social factors that have played into that, right? Like, it used to be much more shameful to be a pregnant teen, white or black, right? So there used to be more adoption. So there used to be more white babies available for adoption. Now those are much harder to come by because, you know, maybe people are actually raising them.
Or they're pricing.
And,
I mean, they're
yeah,
50,
and then, yes, and then,
the
course,
market.
Yeah, exactly. Then there's been a division of, you know, so there's a private adoption market where the white babies go, and then there's a public adoption market. Which is actually, you know, more or less free. You know, it's not as expensive, and where children with, you know, any sort of who are not white or any sort of health issues or who are older or whatever kind of go into. So there's the sort of foster care and sort of public services place to get children, which you can do quite inexpensively and quickly. Even relative to the private adoption. Then there's this, you know, very competitive, inexpensive private adoption market. So I think even that sort of division of the market into sort of the very desirable, healthy white infants and then everybody else. And so already when you're sort of choosing to go either towards the private adoption market or towards the reproductive technology direction, you've already decided that there's a specific type of child you're looking for, and you're willing to pay a lot of money for it.
Yeah, that's all I was wondering.
Yeah.
It just seems like there's a previous
yeah.
racial choice that's
yeah.
already taken place before
yes.
you've entered the
I think
area.
That's, yeah,
period,
absolutely
right?
true.
Right.
Yeah.
Just because it's expensive.
Yes.
We have time for one more question.
I'm sort of wondering what the barriers of entry for lower class families, or, you know, a middle class Indian family versus a well off Scandinavian family, and what levels of barriers they have to go through to be a part of the process.
It depends. I mean, obviously there's financial stuff. There's also legal stuff. So one of the other reasons that international reproductive markets exist is because of differing laws in different countries. So it's not the only reason to go. The only reason to go from the U.S. maybe to India is money. But from a variety of other countries, the reasons to go somewhere else to try to get a child or whatever can have to do with the laws in the country as well. So there are sort of. There are legal barriers. Actually, the one law that the Indian government did see fit to do was to not let same-sex couples come in and use Indian surrogates and take babies. So that was nice of them to come up with some kind of regulation to, you know, make it harder for just one group without still any concern for the actual surrogate women. So there are sort of different legal barriers and then financial barriers. I don't know, was there something else you wanted to kind of get at? Or?
I'm having a hard time. It's sort of on what Mark was talking about. In Asia, it was very popular that people were only having one baby and there was a big pregnancy problem. So sort of as opposed to having only, you know, surrogate families, why not using the pool of babies that are more or less unwanted? But
and it's interesting. I mean, international adoption is a whole very related thing, but that there's been quite a bit of work done on it. So I chose to do work on something there wasn't quite as much work on, but there are a lot of interesting connections and differences. So I do think that as was pointed out, kind of by the time you're trying to do the IVF, the IVF stuff or some of the, you've already decided against an international option and stuff like that. So there's this idea that it's okay, and there's a discourse for why it's okay to adopt children from foreign countries, because like you're rescuing them and it's kind, and you're going to improve their lives and all this kind of stuff. But there's not that idea, but you're not supposed to sort of create these like mildly undesirable children like from scratch. You're just supposed to sort of like save them, right? You know, like, so there's sort of, I mean, there's these sort of different ways of sort of thinking about that are interesting, and I think kind of come out when you look at what people can, which options people consider and at what cost, and kind of what is the sort of most preferable and what comes next, and then which way do you go. I think as you sort of start to examine these choices, and I never mean actually to attack the individuals who make these choices. So I think it's really, and they make them within very very specific long historical social context, and I don't think they always, a lot of this stuff I don't think occurs to people, and people are also, of course, in a really vulnerable and within a really vulnerable position and a really intimate problem, and these sort of deeply held desires for family, and a lot of sort of deeply held and unquestioned feelings about what family is and how it looks and how it feels and what it means, right? And so I don't think that there's a lot of sort of clear-headed, socially aware, economic analysis going into this, right? People aren't sort of saying, well, this child is worth this $20,000 to me because it's white. I don't think that's how people are thinking about it, right? So I don't want to sort of start criticizing people's individual choices about how to pursue a family or, whom they're going to adopt or what they're going to do. But I do think that when we look at those choices in context, we start to see things about who and what are value, was valued in the world and the histories that sort of made it that way.
Well, we can continue the conversation over snacks. Let's thank Dr. Camisha Russell.